Look at them. Look how cross they are. This is astounding. Can you believe it? I don't know if you can hear them growling. Look at the hyena coming up behind them. So we, just like the lions, I think we've stumbled on the den site now. It sounds like there's a tractor here, everybody. All those lions are growling and they're surrounded. Oh, here they come. To the left-hand side, I'm just going to tell you, we're going to stay on the lions, if you like, Jandre. To the left of them, there seems to be a gathering of hyenas. They're moving in now. That's what these lions are facing. I think come wider, but Jandre, they might be quite close. There they are. Now, as we know, even if you are at a den site, if they're very young cubs, they'll just disappear down into the termite mound. They'll be completely safe. But these hyenas is a big clan. It's a big clan apparently of about 50 of them. And if they start to rally each other, these lions will be in trouble. See, they don't want to move. Oh, this is amazing. This is exactly why we wanted to come here and do this, everyone. They might not be hunting, but we're witnessing one of the most ancient battles there is in nature. Hyenas versus lions. One and two. On the predator hierarchy out here, sometimes one, sometimes two for both of them. Look at those hyenas coming in. There's no natural light on them at all. That's all infrared. So although it might look like we might be favoring one over the other, we are not. Look at them. One, two, three, four, five, six. Like I say, the lion's growling. I'm not sure why six lions should be afraid of this many hyenas, but there might be others, perhaps on the other side, around here. Gosh, this is special. So if you have just joined us, everyone, we're here in the Mara Triangle. This is the Kitchotembo Pride, the principal pride of lions up in the northern parts of the triangle. This is an ancient hyena clan. They've had dens here for probably 1,000 years. And these, them and their ancestors, their antecedents, have been fighting over these plains for millennia. There is a bit of moisture getting into the car, everybody. Jandre? Oh, gosh. Oh, Josh. Hang on, everyone. I'm going to move this bag. It's got very wet. It's got camera equipment in it. This is the great trials of doing what we're doing in very cramped conditions. Jandre, you okay back there?
Yeah, sorry.
Jandre, you want to know if a large group of hyenas could kill these lions? Well, yes, but it would have to be very large. Just to the right, I think quite close to us, Jandre, there's a hyena. If you need a jacket at all, there's one. Okay, we're coming out of IR. We're going to go to white light.
No. I mean the hyena's not in IR.
Oh, I see. Sorry. Never mind. Graham, do we need to cross over for a little while? Everybody, we might have to leave you just in case we need to kind of batten down the hatches quickly. But we're okay for now. Isn't this amazing? I don't know where the hyenas are. I can't see them. I think they've headed off. And the wind is blowing. You might be able to hear it. The rain is pouring now. It does seem to be easing slightly, which is good news. And the lions ain't going nowhere. Now, just look at the way they're lying. You see there three or four of them facing one way, one the other, and one sort of out in the outlying areas. They're watching all angles. There's another one coming in, calling. Ooh, hyena, I mean. Ooh. And now they're it's like trying to get some sleep, I imagine, at the Battle of the Somme in one of the trenches. And they're still growling, they're still not happy. Anything to the right there, Jandro? You want me to turn?
Yeah.
Okay, we're just going to turn everybody. Alright, we're just going to clean the lens, everyone. You haven't gone black screen, you haven't lost signal, it's just Jandri getting the rain off the lens there. And those hyenas will not be far away. Right, there's at least one young male moving off now. He's not scared, that fellow. He was marking territory, a very unusual thing for a male his age to be doing. Yeah, he's chasing off there. I'm reticent to go too far around them. I don't think he's going to attack on his own, so I think we're going to wait here. There's some noise. Yeah, coming in from the left, coming in from the left. That's the lion you can hear growling. Ooh, ooh. I think we're going to have to move to see what's going on the other side there. Okay, everyone, I cannot see what's happening. There could be endless numbers of holes here that the hyenas have gone into. Big hole in front of us. I think they've isolated that male lion. I think he'll come back towards support here. Look, there he is. You see the male there? Guys, I can't move. Graham, can you see front left, if I can go front left and around this bush? Yeah, I am asking you to look front left. Is there a hole front left? Yes, I can see that. Can I go front left? I'm going to go around this thicket. So everyone, I cannot... Oh gosh. No. We're going to get stuck in here, everyone. They're not going to go in there. We lost traction there quite badly. Alright. While we sort ourselves out here, everyone, let's head across to Tayla, find out what she's doing. I think she's got some elephants. This is tremendously exciting. We'll try and get you a good picture of it shortly.
We followed these elephants for quite some time, and they've managed to find themselves a pool of water that they are happily drinking from. They're not having a big drink, it's just a quick little drink, so possibly they have been drinking throughout the day. Some of them did look like they had some mud covering their bodies. So perhaps they had a mid-afternoon puzza, is what we would call it in South Africa. A puzza, a drink. And I didn't want to bring out the spotlight, everybody. The elephants would not take very likely to a spotlight shining in their eyes. So we decided to put the infrared on. It's a little bit light still for the infrared, but I think it's quite nice to see these elephants without bothering them too much. You can even see this little calf here on the right having a little drink. There we go. How's that? So this just shows them that they are quite happy with us being here and watching them as the sun disappears. Normally, at this time of the night, we would have actually have left the elephants alone. But we are so fortunate to have infrared. Hello, Ellie's. Oh, all the calves are suckling. That's incredible. Even the one on the left now is suckling her calf. So they're just taking a little break. They moved quite a long distance in a very short space of time. They sort of stopped eating and powered forward. Now, a vital piece of equipment to an elephant is its trunk. And Kate wants to know this evening, if an elephant was born without its trunk, could it survive? Kate, I don't think it would be able to survive. They rely on that trunk so much to be able to break branches and strip leaves from those branches and pop them in their mouth, as well as for drinking water. Sorry, everybody, I need to just reposition. It's okay, girl. It's okay. I'm just moving out the way, everybody. Female is not too happy. I just want to give them ample space. And now they're fine again. Now they're carrying on. Sorry, girl, was I in your pathway? And most likely what's happened here is this, a female elephant probably comes and drinks at this watering hole on a regular basis. And that is her route from the watering hole straight down and onto the road again. And obviously I didn't know this, so I just had to apologize and move out the way. And now she's happy again. She says, it's okay, no problem, Tayla, I forgive you, but just remember for next time that this is the pathway that I like to walk. And now hopefully we'll be able to watch here and watch them drink without bothering them too much. So sorry, Kate, yes, I think that an elephant would unfortunately not survive should it be born without a trunk. I don't know how they would really drink water either. You can see how they suck the water up into their trunk and then they squirt it back into their mouth. Unless it were to go down onto its knees and try and suck the water somehow, I'm not sure how they would be able to do that. Right, well, we carry on watching these elephants drink a little bit of water. Let's go see how Jamie is doing with the king of the savannah bush.
The king of the bush. I don't know, I feel like the king of the bush title definitely goes to the elephants, but our massive male lion is on the move. And we're going to try and keep up with him for as long as we possibly can. Alrighty, let's go. This is where the fun starts, and soon I'm hoping he's going to call. This is the same male that we watched disappear off our boundary to the south last night. It's the same Birmingham boy. So last night he walked a good 20 or so kilometers. I'm going to take the road, by the way, for now, because I think he's going to follow quite a well-worn game path. Now, predators generally walk on roads or on well-established paths because they're quieter. It's a way of moving stealthily through the bush without having to worry about things getting in his eyes or twigs or sticks, having to duck or anything like that. I'm hoping he's going to... There he is. Whoopsie, nearly drove Dave into a tree in my excitement. We do have a limited amount of time that we can spend with him, but we're going to try and spend as long as we possibly can. He saw something in the bush there. I could see his body language change, stopped to listen. He's not gone into stalk mode, which is why we are still able to use the spotlight. He's not hunting. I think he's going to walk straight to where those sticks have a buffalo carcass. Not too far from here, just outside of our boundary. Okay, let me stop here as he walks across into the light. He's going to come. There he is. A slow and steady stride that casually eats up the miles as he travels along at night. Stopping to listen, I think I heard a lion roar far away. He might be listening to that. It's amazing how quiet these cats are when they walk. Not a sound coming from him, stopping to mark his territory, urine scent marking. So the same deal as what we saw yesterday evening as we followed him along Twin Dams. Scent marking, scraping his feet. Basically what he's doing there is he is transferring the scent of the urine onto the pads of his feet so that as he walks along it spreads the scent with him. Something that rhino do as well, and leopards. Quite a few animals do out here. He's going to cut the corner and pop out on the road. That's what I think he's going to do. He's quickened his stride now. He's moving much, much faster. He's actually almost trotting. Let's go over to James, see what's happening there.
There's a hunt going on, everybody. There's a little antelope in front of us. We've switched down all the white light. This lioness is heading straight towards it. The hyenas are also all around. The rain is heaving out of the sky. The wind is blowing. And there's a little, and there, no, just the other side of the mound, there was a little antelope. Looked like a Thompson's gazelle or an impala. And one of those lions came running at it. It looked very panicked, because I'm pretty sure it can hear the hyenas and the lions having a conflict here. The rain is really teeming out of the sky. Look at them go now. They may just be playing, they may be hunting. It's pitch, pitch black, everyone. The hyenas are shouting in front of us. And just hear them going. I'm going to try and go to the left. There is a hole there. You may hear Jandre instructing me. That is fair enough, of course. Unfortunately, I may get us into a very large hole. Look at them playing there. Oh, that's just play behavior. They seem to be quite pleased that they've avoided the hyenas. Jandre, on a scale of 1 to 10, how wet are you?
Very, very wet.
Jandre is a 12 out of 10 wetness. I'm quite comfortable. I'm about 2 out of 10, everyone. My right shoe, for some reason, seems to be sitting in a puddle. But this is a Land Rover, so it's not unusual that there should be puddles congealing in various parts of it. May just be able to see the flashes of lightning there in the background. Gosh, this is very exciting indeed. Yeah, Andrine, you're right. I mean, to a certain extent, you're right. You say we don't fully comprehend what we miss when we don't drive around at night. Yes, that is to a certain extent true, but it's not easy. And it's not easy technologically to make it work. And that's one of the reasons we don't do too much night driving. But also, the real advantage of doing it here, and I mean it's playing out at Juma as well, because we have that lion there, and they don't seem to be moving too much, the lions, at the moment. But here, there's so much space, and it's fairly sort of wood-free, which means that we can keep going through the bush at night and follow these lions on the hunt. Big storm in the south. You can just see the lightning flashes going. Jandre, all I can hear is.
What did you say, Jandre?
I'll
relay.
3 o'clock.
You have a lens problem at 3 o'clock. Well, as long as it's only at 3 o'clock, Jandre, we'll be okay. Everyone, Jandre at the moment is sitting out with his head out the roof, being shielded by Graham Wallington with a bright red umbrella. And really, it's very difficult. Ooh, they're... No, I thought they were stalking. They might be stalking here. Look, they're hunting. She's up. She's hunting. I'm going to go around the other side of them. There. Look, look. They're on the chase. Topi. Chasing Topi. Another one coming there. Topi very fast, everybody. The fastest of the antelope. This one coming around the side. One of them's clearly gone off to try and head them off. There go the Topi. You can just see them in the distance there. Sorry about the water. Nothing we can do. I'm going to avoid a hole. Oh, they are definitely on the hunt, everyone. I suspect the other lionesses have gone round the other side, perhaps to chase them towards these ones. Sorry about the cloth. Can you see anything, Jandri? There we go. They're trotting along now. Maybe those Topi got away. Like I say, they're tremendously fast and they can run for a long time. Oh, hang on. What's going on here? They're looking left and right. I've got a feeling something's going to happen here. They're definitely stalking through here, everyone. Isn't this exciting? This is what the hyenas were hoping for, you know. They were hoping that these lions would kill something for them. Fresh meat that they didn't have to get. I don't know where the others are, but these two would definitely be running if there was something afoot. How many you got there, Jandri? I've only got two. Just the two so far. Gosh, this is tremendous, isn't it? This is exactly why we came here, everyone. Who knows if they'll kill? They may not. But we're watching them hunting live in the Mara Triangle. It's a rainy African night, which makes it excellent for the lions. You can maybe see that flashing of lightning in the background there. And the rain and the wind and the hyenas are making it very, very interesting indeed. I'm just going to stop here for a brief second. I'm just going to turn off, just in case they need to listen. But with this wind, I think it's going to be very difficult. I think this is largely a visual hunt going on here. Look at them, they're still stalking. Gonna keep going, they're still stalking. Let's move a little bit closer towards them. Try not to drive. Hey, hold on, everyone. That may have been a road we just went over. Okay, big bumps, everybody. Hold on tight. It's a big road, I think, of some sort. Might be the Mara River. No, I don't think it's the Mara River. Hold on, everyone. Now Jandre is wet and has broken ribs. How are your ribs, Jandre? Here's the rest of the pride. He says, yeah. Is that a lion to the right-hand side there? No, it's a stick. Our cat, of course, doesn't like the rain like this. Luckily, Jandre and Graham are not cats. They love it. Don't you, Jandre and Graham? You love the rain. Absolutely, says Jandre. Graham's gone totally silent. This is only the second time in his life he's been silent, everyone. I, of course, will get a thick ear when we finish this, but you know, that's how it goes. I mean, the difference between the fat sleeping cats last night to this is just astounding, isn't it? No idea where I am, everybody. If you had to say to me, point home, couldn't do it. Yep, got it, thank you. Heading left. Hello, Spirulina. You want to know if the headlights are silhouetting the lions. I've got a very, very dim light on, Spirulina. I'll turn it off for you. You'll see that all of this light being shed is from the infrared. There, you see, that's all infrared light. There's not one little bit of white light there, which means that they're not being silhouetted in the slightest. Nothing can see them coming. I've got a very dim light on the floor in front of me so that I don't drive into an aardvark hole, but it's not shining on the lions. It is purely infrared light there. It feels a bit boggy in here. Anyway, keep going. This is very special indeed. Lion to the left, lion to the right. Going up to check if he can see anything. Now, just to keep you posted, if you haven't been watching recently, this is the Kichwa-Tembo Pride. Well, we think it is. We were told 6 lionesses. This is clearly 5 lionesses and at least 1 male lion, a young male. And then we have been seeing the other female. Look, she's just listening. I'm just going to turn off. Let her listen and smell. And the territory's just been taken over by 3 males, the Marsh Male Coalition. And they've come from the other side of the Mara River, from the domain of the very famous Marsh Pride of Big Cat Diary fame. You can see she has clearly been lactating. There were 7 cubs in this pride. We think they are all dead. I'm just going to let them regroup. So the only potential disturbance, everyone, that we could give is the noise of the engine. But because it's so rainy and so windy, I don't think it's going to make any difference. It'd be a bit different if they were wild dogs. And these chaps are hunting on sight, largely, almost exclusively. Hello, Valeria. Oh, as that lioness yawns with the effort of this hunt. You say, how is it that this young male lion has managed to survive so far with a male takeover? Well, Valeria, it's because he's exactly the right age. He's about 2, and that means he's old enough to escape the attentions of the males because there's no one suckling him at the moment. And secondly, yes, he will be thrown out by those males eventually. There's no question that they will not put up with him. But they'll let him stay until he hits puberty, which will be in about 6 months, I imagine. Gosh, I'm getting my right ears a bit wet now, everyone. Oh, look! Is that a lion? Yes, sorry. I thought it was an antelope. Hang on, John, go right, go right, go right. Go in there. Look, something's going on here. We're going to just turn to the right slightly. They're definitely stalking. They've seen something. And I just wanted you to understand, I can see absolutely nothing but for on the monitor in front of me. Now, that looked like a hole that you jumped over there. Keep an eye out for holes, please, everybody. Anything left, Graham? Anything to the left? There's something afoot here, everyone. Look, 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 she's moving. You're gonna stay with her. She stalks there. There, 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 look, look. Something's going on. I don't know what it is. Look, 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 look. Look. This is fascinating. Look, something is happening. I think the others have gone around the side of this bush. I'm going to turn off here, Jean-Raymond. It might be hyenas. She's looking a bit nervous rather than in hunting mode. That's the young male, or a young male. Is that a lion there, top left, Jean-Ré, or is that a hyena? It's a lion. Guys, they're hunting something in this thicket, somewhere around here. I think we're going to follow the lioness we were with. If we can find her. You see, there she is. She's waiting here. There she goes. This is so exciting, isn't this amazing? I don't want to cut the engine just yet. Let's keep with her. I think that's the best option for now. She's part of the ambush, clearly. How she's communicating with the others, I don't know. There she goes in front of us. She's coming back this way. Coming back this way. Look behind her. What's behind there? Jean-Ré, those hyenas. Hyenas coming in. Follow the lions and the hyenas. Gosh, this is unbelievable. He's yelling now. Move a bit quicker. You're on an elephant path. There's the lioness. They've surrounded her. They've surrounded her. I think she's on her own. I think she's isolated. It's a young male. Sorry, I keep thinking it's a female, but it isn't. It's definitely a young male. Let's follow him. Where's that hyena, Jean-Ré?
Hyena's on 3 o'clock.
And any lions that side that you can see?
Negative.
Let's follow the male. Can you see him there? There he is. He's straight in front of us, 12 o'clock. Him chasing there. I don't know what's going on here. If they're hunting, if they're trying to just avoid the hyenas. The others look to be hunting to me, although this might be the same chap who isolated himself earlier. Gosh, this is amazing. Just to reiterate, I can't see anything. I'm following this lion purely on the monitor. Susie, you want to know why they... Look at this meeting! Look at this! They've found each other again. That's another young male. There are at least two young males. Right, that's good news. Well, it's interesting news. It's something we didn't know. Susie, you want to know why the hyenas are fighting with the lions? Susie? It's because I think there's a den here. I think there's a hyena den here. Susie, it's because, well, they are the top two predators and they compete with each other and they will harass each other at every available opportunity. What was that, Jean-Ré?
3 o'clock.
3 o'clock. Where are we going?
9 o'clock.
Thank you. 9 o'clock. There we are. Oh, they're all there. Let's take a breath, everybody. How fantastic is this? You okay there, Jean-Ré?
Yeah.
Good, he's just giving a little... What's going on here? I'm going to follow her. The others are going straight in front of us now. Ooh, something's going on here. What's the male to the left of that one, Jean-Ré? There he goes. Now, when you see them turning like that, when you see them kind of spreading, it's normally a sign that another one is sort of on ambush. But I suspect it might be the hyenas here that's causing them to act the way they are. Look, look, look. Are they at 12?
12.
We've got them in front there. No, you can't see anything. I was diving straight into the rain. No idea what's going on now. Let's keep us going in this direction. We might be lucky. Okay, we're going to turn on a bit of white light, everyone, so we can see. There they are. Hold on, big bumps. There we go. That's a lion, is it? Let me just do that again. Once more, flash. They're right in front of us. Now, following lions from behind like this is the best idea if you don't want to affect their hunt, of course, because you don't want to chase anything into them. They're not affected by vehicles. Antelope certainly would be affected by a vehicle following them from behind. So much better that you follow the lions like this, because they don't care what we're doing. And likewise, a little bit of light that there is not shining on them. Oof, there's a lot of hunting going on here. Hold on, everyone, we're going to back to a main road. These lions have been walking all over the place. Now, you can imagine, you've seen us trying to track lions, how very difficult it is to try and track lions, because look, they're not running, walking in a straight line by any stretch of the imagination. I'm going to try and get over this little section here. Looks like we can do it over here. I'm going to have to turn the lights on to get over here, otherwise we're going to have a bit of an accident. There we are. Up we go. Good grief. There we go, this is so exciting. That's interesting. Nice question from Jane. You're saying, do I think that the male lion could have been drawing the hyenas away from the females? Yeah, maybe. It's possible. There's some stalking behavior going on here. What is this in front of us, Graham? Is that a road or a very large diff? It's a ditch that we're going to have to go around. Okay, everyone, we're going to have to get around this ditch. We're not going to be able to... I think I must go the other way around it. Think we can get up and over there, Graham? Do you think we can get up and over here? Okay, I'm going to go for it. Hold on, everyone. All right, let's go to Jamie, everybody. Get an update from the Birmingham boys. We'll try and reassess. Take a deep breath and we'll see you shortly.
What a spectacular sighting it sounds like you've been having all the way in Kenya. In the meantime, we are still with our Birmingham boy, who is getting very, very close to the boundary of Mkoro, which is a property to the north of us that we can't drive. Now, I'm whispering very softly because there are other guests in the vehicle next to us, so I don't want to disturb their incredible sighting of this magnificent animal. While you were with James, two of the Styx females came out, looked at the male, went and had a drink, and then left again. No sign of the cubs, so I'm not quite sure what's happening. Maybe they've left a babysitter with the cubs, they're off hunting once again. I'm not 100% sure where they're off to. I could still hear the cubs growling at each other, probably about 700 meters away from where I am. So they're still around, they haven't come through in this direction. No sign of them following the other females. So for now, we get to enjoy spending a little bit of time with this male lion. And he's given us a few sort of, not quite false starts, but almost like he's about to yawn, but he doesn't. We're going to sit here for as long as possible, but let's head across to James in the Mara Triangle.
Right, everyone, they started to hunt again. I'm just going to turn off, let's see if we can hear what's going on other than the pounding of the rain and the blasting of the wind. The hyenas are still calling. Every time it looks like they're doing some kind of hunting, I think the hyenas get in their way. She should see where she's looking. Is that a lion or a hyena in the distance there, Jandri? Coming straight towards us now. Ooh, two lions. If you have just joined us, we are live from the Mara Triangle, everybody. It's pounding rain, conditions appalling, but not for the lions. They're perfect for the lions. These lions of the Kichwetembo pride on the hunt, but their hunts keep being ruined by a clan of hyenas. There we have a standoff. They're not a standoff, just going to the loo, I think. Gosh, this is amazing. They're also engaging in a bit of play behavior. Watch this, she's going to pounce Jandre to the left. Unless there's something coming in other than a lion, but there isn't. This is completely, of course, it's pitch black. I cannot see a thing other than on the monitor I'm looking at. We're filming in infrared, if you're wondering why the colour's like this. That's why it's like this. My name is James Henry. Jandre is on camera. You're watching Safari Live, and some of you, I think, are watching on Barcroft TV. It's wonderful to have you with us. And you can talk to us throughout the course of this broadcast on Twitter, hashtag Safari Live. Otherwise, you can send us an email, questions@wildearth.tv. You do not have to worry that I will be reading the email while driving. Someone very clever in Johannesburg will be reading it to me. Not Johannesburg, in the Kruger Park, actually. That's where the Twitter and email will be received. Jandre, can you see a lion anywhere? I've lost them. I'm going to turn some light on. There we go. I can see one there in front of us. They're in front of us here somewhere, everybody, and I saw some other eyes ahead. It could be that they're on the hunt again. They definitely look to be hunting. They've done a great big circle. There, there. What's off to the right-hand side? Something ran. Well, we kind of lost them, I'm afraid. Left. Been spotted left, everyone. There we go. What's that? What's that to the left? Lions. They've killed. Have they killed something? They've killed. They've killed. A little zebra. My goodness, look at that, everybody. That's why we came here. How quickly did that happen? I just saw them run, and there they've killed a little zebra. I'm sorry we missed it, everyone, but we did actually. We're here seconds after it happened. For those of you who are sensitive viewers, that zebra is dead. There is no feeling there. That's Jandre just cleaning the lens so that the picture is better. Looks like a young zebra, and I think they killed one yesterday as well. These hungry lions are going to be very satisfied tonight. Now, let's see if the hyenas come in. I can hear them calling behind. Ooh, ooh, yes, they're going to come in here. Here we go, they're massing now. These lions will wolf down some food. They don't know how big this clan is. Over 20 hyenas coming from behind us, everyone. We're in perfect position here. There is no white light on them, on that zebra. Look how quickly they're trying to devour it before the hyenas move in. The hyenas will be very nervous to come in. Six lions like this. But if they get enough of them, this is exactly why we came here, everyone. Lion kill live in the Mara Triangle. in complete darkness. It's raining, and the lions have killed a young zebra. They're growling, the hyenas are massing, trying to encourage each other. Look at this. Isn't this amazing? Ellen, you're wondering if the sense of smell is going to be dulled by the rain, allowing the hyenas to come closer. No, it's not going to make any difference now. Those hyenas are massing. Genre, can we go wide? There they are. There they come. There they come, everybody. Look at this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 so far. And Graham, you said 20 from behind us. This is too amazing for words. Listen to them, geeing each other up. It's like a war cry before a team goes onto the sports field.
Maybe another 20 coming on now.
Graham thinks there are a whole number of others coming from behind there. Listen to them getting more and more angry as they try and eat as much of the zebra before they have to leave it. I wonder if this is why they didn't leave a piece of the zebra that they ate yesterday. Maybe the hyenas chased them off. Can you hear them, everyone? Ooh. Ooh. I'm having to do it for you because I think the ambient microphone is off. This is too special. The Kichwa Tembo pride has killed a young zebra. This ancient clan of hyenas, whose ancestry probably stretches thousands of years back, homing in on the pride as they have done for millennia. Chandra, is the ambient up?
Yeah.
Okay, so you can hear the noises now, everyone. Probably also the sounds of Jandre getting pneumonia, but that's okay. He's loving this. Why aren't they coming in? This is interesting. See, when it comes to actual physical contact, the hyenas need to outnumber these lions by at least 3-1. Here we go, coming closer in now. Look at this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And I wonder if they're not taking the risk because, of course, there's so much food around here. They can't resist trying to get one over on their old arch enemy. There. Look at the claws underneath. That's why lions have scars all over their faces, normally fighting with their kith and kin at a kill like this. If you are a sensitive viewer, I'm sorry about this, but this is the raw wonder of Africa that we're watching here. This is how it happens in the wild. That zebra feels nothing, probably felt nothing, didn't know what hit it. And the lions need to feed. They were hungry. They've been hungry. Look at all the hyenas. Listen to them calling each other. There's something holding them back. None of the light that you can see there is anything other than infrared. That's why they keep disappearing from your field of view. There's a rather braver one coming in now. Classic story is playing out here. The hyenas are running all around the place. You just see their shadows. What a privilege, everyone. What an amazing privilege to be here. Here come the hyenas again, geeing each other up. Zebra is going to be finished in the next 20 or 30 minutes. Hi, Susan. Well, that's a very good question for you. Say, are the lions less aggressive than they are with each other while they're feeding because of the hyenas, because they're just concentrating on wolfing down as much as possible? Susan, I think that's not a bad theory, actually. But they are not being particularly friendly with each other, but yes, I think perhaps they're very hungry. They're going to devour as much as they can before they move on. They may even hunt again. Look, 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 here we go. There's that typical aggression. And that sound you can hear, that kind of pitter-pattering, might sound a little bit like flesh being rendered or rent, but it isn't. It is the rain just falling down on the car and on the umbrella that's shielding Gendre ineffectually just above us. Wowee. One of them's been very brave and taken his little piece off there. Gabby from Toronto, you're interested in whether this will satiate the lions. Will it keep them full or will they hunt again tonight? I think it's possible they'll hunt again. I don't think they'll be quite as enthusiastic about it as they have been. It's not a big zebra at all, like I say. I think it'll be finished in the next half hour or so, maybe 20 minutes. And then they may go off and hunt again. They might do some territorial marking. But you can see, I mean, you could see from their behavior straight away when they got going today that meat was on their minds. And these conditions perfect, the rain, the wind. Interestingly, they headed off with the wind. And often they head off into the wind, seemingly aware that their prey might smell them coming. You don't see this every day, do you? Gendre, do you see this every day?
No.
No, I don't see this every day. Gendre says no, he doesn't see this every day. It's pretty savage, but it is astounding. And it's a great story of how these lions survive. Kitrotembo pride going through a rough patch at the moment after a new pride takeover. The three new males, the marsh male coalition, away with the youngest member of this pride. She's kind of drawn them away in a state of anaestrus, kind of half getting ready to mate again with them. They've killed all their cubs, and here they are surviving, making do as lions have done for goodness knows how long in this astounding wilderness area that we find ourselves in. In case you've just joined us, from the Mara Triangle we are broadcasting live. The zebra has just been killed. We just missed it being taken down, but we've been following these lions on the hunt for the last hour and a half or so. I don't know how long we've been following them. It feels like about 3.5 minutes, but it's probably been about an hour and a half. And they just went out of sight, grabbed the zebra, and we found them again, right on top of it. You can send us any questions you want, hashtag SafariLive, questions@wildearth.tv. This is why we came to the Mara Triangle, to watch these lions hunting on the great plains of East Africa, as they have done for millennia. And everything is calming down now. The hyenas thinking twice about coming in here, interestingly. And quite interestingly, some of them looked very, very full indeed. Some of them looked very fat. And so maybe they're just a bit reticent about coming in here because they are fat. They stumbled earlier on, if you've just joined us, onto the hyena den itself. We nearly drove into a hole on top of a hyena cub. We backed out, and then the hyenas got very cross, not with us, with the lions. And the lions kind of evaded being attacked, and they walked off, and they've done a huge circle. From what I can tell, it's very difficult to orientate yourself, but they've done an enormous circle, say, I would say about maybe 10 hectares, maybe a bit more. So sort of 20 football fields, if you like, they've covered in a big arc. And they've come around not too very far from where we first found them. And that's, I mean, as I was saying, as they came up here, how impossible it is to try and track them in the morning, because they don't go in a straight line. They move all over. And the blessing of African rain, of course, just completing the effect of the evening. And we have been richly, richly blessed here. She Gee whiz, I can't believe this has happened. Our second night here. We've got another three after this, everybody. We'll keep following this pride, especially if they keep knocking off tiny little zebra like this. They're going to be hungry every night. And if you are a sensitive viewer, I do apologize if this has made you slightly upset. It always makes me slightly upset, not so much when I see them feeding, but when I see the moment that the light leaves an animal's eyes, it's a difficult one. And I'm sure you'll all agree that, you know, we've seen the lions feeding now. It's not a particularly emotional experience, but when you see the actual takedown, when you see the light fading, that's a bit difficult. But what an amazing honor it is to watch this ancient conflict playing out here. Hyenas and lions. Look, marking territory. Their blood is up now, you know. And by that I mean they're like, say, young men or sort of particularly sporty ladies, perhaps, who've got into a bit of a fight, and they're ready, you know. They're not nervous anymore. So if those hyenas come anywhere near them, they're going to have a go. So their blood is up. They're like warriors. And I think those hyenas know that, and that's why they're keeping their distance, hoping for the odd scrappy morsel. And there will be some. These lions, they kill a lot, and they'll eat the bone, as well, the small bones. They'll eat all the flesh. They'll eat the organs, the liver, the kidneys, the spleen, and the lungs and the heart. They'll probably leave the guts. And then the hyenas will come in and eat the skin. They'll probably leave the hooves, depending... Ooh, here we go. Ah, the lion on his own. Now they're rallying. But they're reticent. So a hyena is about 70 kilograms, a very big female. That's about 160 pounds odd. That male lion probably pushing 150 kilograms. Or what is that, about 340 pounds. So that's twice the size of that hyena. It will be very, very reticent to go running in there and get on the end of a slap from his great big front paw, or even a bite from his enormous canines. See, they're just rallying each other there. Ooh, Nisa in Wisconsin, you've obviously got a little bit of experience watching lions and hyenas interact. You say, would they be so brave if there was an adult male lion here? Absolutely not. They would be very, very nervous indeed. An adult male lion will not tolerate hyenas that close to him, and they will be very scared. He's fast. He may not look it when he's fast asleep, but he's very quick. He's unimaginably powerfully strong, and with one fell swipe from a great big front paw of his, he'll snap a hyena's spine. And also, just in the background there, you can see the sort of the social structure of the hyena being reaffirmed, the hierarchy. One or two of them running away from one of the others. That's because they've become distracted. They've obviously decided they're not going to close this attack just yet. Perhaps there's not a dominant there. Perhaps these are all youngsters. And so rather like sort of schoolboys on the side of a cricket field or rugby field or soccer field before they actually get on with the game. I guess to reaffirming their social bonds. Now the lion has finished eating. And he's just cleaning his feet. There'll be a lot of moisture he's getting off that, of course, from the rain. Hello, Jacob. You're 11 years old and in London. It's very nice to have you from the UK. It's really good to speak to someone from the UK out here. And we know that the UK has a very close association here with the Mara Triangle. And you say, do the lions here have any noticeable sort of behavioural differences compared with the lions of the Kruger? Now, Jacob, that is an amazingly sophisticated question for someone of your age, so well done. And the answer is no, not really. If you were to uplift the Nkuhuma pride from Juma and dump them here, they would behave very much in a similar fashion to these lions. What is interesting though, Jacob, and we're not fully cognizant, we don't fully understand what's going on here at the moment. It does seem that the pride dynamics... Oh, look at this, look at this, look at this. Jacob, I'll get back to you now. He's going to bite that lion's tail. He's going to get a swipe. So, Jacob, we don't, it's very clear, Juma, what happened. We know about the Birmingham boy takeover. We know what the Nkuhumas have done. We know exactly who the prides are, where the male territory stretch, where the lioness's territory stretch. That's not so clear here. And I'm not sure if that's just because we don't know and things, or if things are slightly different, if things are a bit more fluid, or if that great big river running through the middle of the territory, which is not easy for lions to cross, is perhaps affecting it. But Jacob, I would say, all in all, if you were to put the Nkuhumas here, they would behave the same as the Kichwa pride, and likewise, if you were to put the Kichwas at Juma, I think they would behave in precisely the same way. What a great question. Thank you, Jacob. Look at those hyenas. Just got a bit of a fright there. Friend walked into the bottom, thought maybe it might be a lion. The rain is lessening slightly, just enough to irritate Jean-André by dripping onto his ears. Look, 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 look. Now, Ellen, you're in Arkansas, and you're a long-time viewer, I know, and you say, is there a difference in the way that they hunt here compared with how they hunt at Juma, based on the terrain? Interestingly, I'm not sure it's only the terrain. I think it's the density of prey. Obviously, at Juma, we know that there's a lot more wood, which means that they tend to use that wood, those woody, the bushes and things, to hide. Here, there was none of that. There wasn't an attempt to hide at all. It was largely, purely, the cover of darkness that they used to hunt. And I think you'll probably find out here, Ellen, I'm going to suggest that they kill fewer big prey like buffalo and adult zebra, because they're able to run away. It's difficult for a lion to hide from their prey here. And the three kills, or the two that we've seen and the one that I've heard of just in the 2 days or 3 days that we've been here, have been young animals. And I think these lions hunt either under cover of darkness or in broad daylight when they can run down a young animal. So they'll run down, say, a young wildebeest or a young warthog, or ambush a warthog, perhaps because the warthog can't see so well. Apparently these lions eat a lot of warthog. Now look, he's stolen something. Didn't even see where he got it. Nice piece of intestine there, delicious. I'm being totally facetious, it's disgusting. So Ellen, I think the terrain and the density of prey does make a difference, but I think you'll find that they run down a lot more than the Juma guys do. The Juma guys do a lot more ambushing, and they're able to take bigger prey as a result of it. And I think also you'll find that, you know, they eat different things. These guys, apparently, at this time of year, lots of wildebeest, lots of zebra. Seldom do they kill buffalo. And then, when the wildebeest and the zebra head down south into the Serengeti, apparently they eat quite a few topi and also a lot of warthog. And I suspect they catch the warthog because the grass is high and the warthogs, well, being a bit like me, can't see over the top of it. Nice question. Thank you, Ellen. Isn't this special? What a great privilege we've had tonight to watch these lions hunting and then eating their meal, and in seemingly harmonious fashion in comparison with some of the hunting and eating that we've seen the Nkuhumas doing. It does help that there are no adult males here. If they'd come in, then there would have been a bit of fireworks, I suspect. See, everything is calmed down now at the same time that the rain is slightly ceasing, like I say, just enough to continue Jean-André's being wet. All right, we're going to take a little breather here. We're going to keep watching these lions and hyenas while Jamie shows you something slightly cuter than anything we've got on offer here.
Look at this. Isn't it amazing? This is what is so cool about these night drives. Oh, where to go? There it is. One of the lesser bush babies, or lesser galago. It is absolutely one of the most fantastic animals that we can see out here. It's one of my favorites to spot. I'm not sure how the cameramen feel about it, but they are utterly adorable when we do get it right. And they just bounce from tree to tree in the most amazing way. The smallest of our primates here on Juma Private Game Reserve And look at that. Can you believe you're watching this beautiful little creature live from the ground? It's hunting, looking for insects and moths that it can catch. You can see those massive eyes hard at work. They're all here, little bush baby. All the bugs and moths are in my car. I can't actually take my eyes off it, otherwise I'll lose it. Here it is. Okay, we're going to have a jump. We're going to have a massive jump, I think, into the next tree. See the head bobbing from side to side. Oh, no, we've changed our mind. We're going the opposite way. Ah, oh, this is such a obliging bush baby. Bounce. Oh. You go. They really are one of my favorite animals to look at. So up until recently they have been surviving on tree sap, but now they have an insect boon after the rain, climbing right to the tippity top of that tree. Still there, just hidden behind the branch. You can just, there we go. Isn't it adorable? Oh, look at you standing up. Imagine having that kind of balance right up at the top of this tree. Unbelievable. Glancing from side to side. Now they catch moths by this incredibly rapid hand movement that they are capable of doing. Reaching out and closing. They've got primitive hands, not like human beings with our opposable thumbs. Here he goes, down again, there we go. Here we go. Oh, bounce. Keeping you guessing, Dave. This is why I feel like our cameramen are probably some of the best in the world, because they have to deal with sneaky little creatures like this bush baby. It's got a piece of stick hanging from its tail. That's the thorns have hooked into the tip of the fur there. You can see it glancing about. I wish we could tell it to come here, because we have all of the insects in our vehicle at the moment. All of them. A couple of them are in my shirt. And crawling around my feet. crawling up my trouser leg. Little bush baby, you would have a field day if you were in here. Oh, this is amazing. You can even see that I think it is a female. Just glancing up like that. And it is very definitely on the hunt. How cool is this? Now, we know of a couple of bush baby nests, but I've decided this evening we're doing a border patrol to get an idea of just what the boundaries of Juma hold. This is what we in South Africa call a nahapi, which means a little night monkey, which I think is an even better name than a lesser bush baby. The name bush baby comes from the call of the greater bush baby. That sounds very much, stopping for a little grooming session there. Sounds very much like a crying baby. It really does. Wah! Oopsie. I have to concentrate on looking at the bush baby in real life and looking at what Dave's looking at through the camera. Adam Lambert, very good question. You were saying, since there are so many insects on the ground and at ground level, why don't the bush babies hunt on the ground? They do occasionally. The greater bush baby hunts more frequently on the ground than the lesser bush baby. And I think it's just because the lesser bush baby feels a bit more threatened and it feels a lot safer up in the protection of dense trees like this one. Or even an aerial predator, something like an owl, for example, would have great difficulty in reaching through the thorns and the sticks and plucking it up. And there are lots and lots of insects up in the trees as well, lots of moths fluttering about, lots of... Hey, get out of my shirt, please. That's very uncomfortable, thank you. The joys of summer have arrived. And I think for the bush baby, it must be such a welcome relief from having to eat a tree sap all day. Well, I say all day, all night, of course. They are totally nocturnal. During the day, they find a nice, safe spot, a branch or a hidden crevice or a hidden spot somewhere in the case of the bush babies that live near the DRC, they live in the tree just above us. And what they do... You're getting attacked there, Dave. I know, me too. When this bush baby disappears, I'll give you an idea of just how under siege we truly are. And you'll get a proper clue as to what we're currently experiencing. But for now, we've got such an amazing view and I really don't want us to miss out. So they sleep, curled up all together in little family groups, adorable, fluffy family groups. And they doze the day away, going into a sort of a torpor, where their muscles all relax, they get completely calm, and they sleep in that manner. And for the most part, they try and find a spot. Dave, you're being attacked. And Amy, you say this is your first bush baby sighting. I've still got him there, Darby. Yes. I don't know where though. There you go. There you go. Up a bit. And there in. Down a bit. Down a bit. There. That's its tail. Amy says this is her first proper bush baby sighting, that they have been just before two glowing eyes in the dark. And Amy, I'm so glad. Amy, did you ask us to find you a bush baby once before on a sunset safari? I know I was asked by an Amy. I'm just not sure if it was you. It was a good few months ago. I don't know if it was you, I hope it is, in which case I'm really, really glad that after all that, we could provide it. Yes, it was that aim. Oh, goodness, smacked to the face by an insect. There you go, he's in the middle of the spotlight, David. Got him, sorry. There we go. A little bit of presenter cameraman teamwork happening here. An insect crawling up my sleeve. I have to get used to summer again. I'm staying still. I'm resisting the urge to move. Just the little tail there. I think it caught something, actually. Or it might just be grooming again. Now, one wonderful thing that bush babies do, for those of you that are thinking, oh, wouldn't that make a lovely little pet? Well, first of all, they bite. But second of all, they urinate on their feet to mark their territories. Well done, Dave. So they urinate, they leak out a couple of drops of urine, so it's not like a steady stream. And then they grab it with their hands, or their front paws, and then they rub it on their back paws. So if you think you want a bush baby, perhaps that might sway your thoughts. Not that we are in any way a fan of people having exotic pets. I strongly, strongly anti the idea. Look at you, little one. Look at that amazing tree climbing skills. Oh. Imagine doing that. I'd have fallen on my head long ago. I've lost it. Hold on. I think I've lost it. I think it's just hidden in that thick clump. And we can't see it. Right, well, since it has... I think it has disappeared. I'll keep an eye. Have you got it?
No,
I've lost it as well. Since our little bush baby, I think, has moved off out into the distance, I thought you might like to see why I've been making such a fuss as we've been going on. So allow me to demonstrate. That's on my dashboard. We've got a fruit chafer here, and we've got one of the longhorn beetles or something relative. No, not a longhorn. It's something small and insect-like. And then, wait for it, let's just wait and see a second, because you'll have to see what my leg looks like. Right, so there you go, that's one there. Okay, and then there's another, flip of mouth. Okay, yummy, I didn't swallow it, just by the way. Yeah, no, just have a look at my leg. Oh, that's just one, look here, Dave. And most of these are fruit chafers, by the way, of different types. We used to call them Christmas beetles in my house. Have a look at the monitor, although it might get a bit weird. There's one there. Okay, there's another one at the bottom of the monitor. And there's one up my sleeve. And if you don't believe me, My sleeve is moving. I think it's roughly, I can't hold my spotlight and fish it out at the same time. Let's see if there's enough light if I hold it up here. There's one over there. That little bump there is a moving bug. Hold on. Hold on a moment. Oh no. Oh no. It's going right up. Ah ha ha! This one. Okay, it's out somewhere. So, just by the way, serious admiration for Dave, who managed to keep the camera steady and zoomed in, because he's in no better condition than I am. The only difference... Ah, no! No! Owie! Yes, it's biting! It's not actually biting me. There. It wasn't actually biting me. They've just got quite, pinchy legs. Here you go. A little more to the light there. Oh, sorry. Wait, there we go. Fruit chafer, everybody. One of the smaller species. That was what was up my sleeve. There's a couple in my shirt as well, but I figure I'll fish those out later. Right, you can go. Excuse me. You can go as well. Oh dear, you've gone already. Now, who knows where you're going to end up. The joys of a life of a field guide in summer in the bush. Should I check and see if our bush babies emerged? I don't... Ah! No! No, no, no! Oh, okay, well, apparently we're finishing up for the evening, which comes as a surprise. Wait, there's one more. Okay, it's gone. It's just gone into my sleeve. There it is. Wait for it. Okay, I've lost it. It's vanished into my sleeve somewhere. Apparently we're finishing up for the evening. So for those of you that joined us, a massive thank you. I hope you had a wonderful time. A big thank you to Dave for his fantastic camera work, as always, as well as to our lovely ladies in Final Control, and a huge thank you to all of you for joining us. Until next time, when we see you again, bye-bye for now, and have a wonderful day.
It's been a while since I've spoken to you last, but I hope that you have all enjoyed James's lions and the catching of the zebra. That sounds very, very exciting. Now, I don't have anything to show you at the moment, but I have got something for you to listen to, so crank up the volume, everybody. Hear all those frogs chattering away. Now, last night we finally found the first frog of the season, which was very exciting. And James Richard wants to know if I managed to ID the frog that I found. And I did indeed, and it isn't a frog. It's called a flat-backed toad, and a very, very small toad. In fact, they don't get more than about 8 centimeters, so quite small. So I was quite excited about that. Now, these frogs that you can hear in the distance, I'm not sure what frogs they are. They definitely are a frog though, they're not a toad. And what they're doing at the moment is called a time sharing. So that's not one frog that you're hearing calling, that's actually a number of different frogs calling in between each other. So not calling and overlapping their calls. As one finishes its call, another one starts to call in between that, and so it goes on. And it makes this beautiful chorus that we're able to hear. And hopefully the female will pick out which one of the male's calls she likes the most. And then she will look for her Romeo. And it's been such a wonderful evening this evening. And it was great out there. We had lots of fantastic things to see. And I hope you're looking forward to the next one, to tomorrow. So I hope to hear some amazing questions again. And we're going to be following up on mongoose again. Don't think I've forgotten about that. That's going to be something I'm definitely going to see. So Eggsy, give a little wave goodbye. And it's been a great chatting to all of you. And a thank you to all the lovely ladies. Oh, and I just want to say thank you as well to all the lovely ladies that are in Final Control. Without them, none of this would be possible. everybody. But before I say goodbye, this is just too magical. So let's just listen to this one last time. Maybe we should put the infrared on. Let's put the infrared on and see what it looks like at the dam. We're actually sitting at Biffles Hook Dam at the moment. It's very dark. I don't think you can actually see too. Oh, you can just see the dam. It's a little bit far away for the infrared lights to sort of see. But nothing happening at the dam tonight. So while you listen away to these wonderful frogs, it was once again a wonderful evening, and I'll see you all tomorrow for another safari marathon.
Well, everyone, there's a great deal of action going on here still. Well, it's starting to quieten down, but the hyenas are getting a little impatient with each other. That lion is eating the head of the unfortunate zebra, which gives it slightly more animation than it actually has. And the hyenas are thinking about coming in to have a go. The rest of the lions to the right-hand side of your picture, they're all satiated to a certain extent. There they all are. Well, there's one of them. In fact, the rest are off to the left. They all seem to be pretty sort of done with their meal, and the hyenas getting impatient with each other, doing a bit of social bonding, having a bit of playing around the place. And, well, I think they've had a great and entertaining evening, rather like we have. They're still nervous, though, and they have to be, because, like I say, they're less than half the mass of these lions. And the lions, John, if you can just go to the right there, there's a lion looking rather satisfied there. There she is, left-hand side, the leftmost lion. Having a bit of a clean, there he is, and he was just lying on his back thinking, how pleasant it is to eat zebra of a Wednesday afternoon. Is it Wednesday? No idea what day it is. It's Wednesday, what a good guess. And you can see his belly quite full. And still the hyenas running around here. Oh, one of them stolen something, John. To the right-hand side. There we go. Got a bit of zebra leg. That will be most sought after by his mates. He's taking it right towards the lion. Looks particularly stupid of him. Now, let's see if they share. Now, hyenas of a similar rank will often share, but the hyena hierarchy is absolutely established at a sighting. Is established at a feeding site. They fight viciously as lions do. One of the lions is up. Let's have a look there to the right-hand side. There we go. Look, nice full belly. Going to have a bit of a snooze, and they'll do the bit of aloe grooming to say, no hard feelings for fighting over the zebra. No, it's okay, I understand you were hungry. Yes, and I understand that you were hungry too. Let's have a little mutual licking, and we'll feel better about each other before we try and perhaps hunt again or snooze it up. The rain seems to have stopped. There's still some growling going on, though, just to the right there, Jean-André. No, that's not growling, is it? That one is there. Very satisfied. And still the zebra's head. Coming in from the left here, Jean-André. Hello, Audrey. You're 12 years old and you say, can we hear the calling of the other zebras now that this one's dead? Audrey, we didn't hear any of that, you know, and I know why you're asking. Probably because you watched that young zebra being killed at Juma. A little while back. Look at them playing there. They're all so well fed, everyone. That's why there's no serious fighting going on here. Audrey, we didn't hear any of that, and I think it's just because it's night time. I think perhaps the rest of the herd panicked and just ran away, or even we've seen a number of orphaned young animals here, wildebeest and zebra. Maybe it's an orphan, and maybe it wasn't with a herd, and maybe that's why they didn't call. But, you know, throughout the day, even sitting way up at the lodge where we're staying, called Ngama Mara, there you can hear zebra calling at each other. That, wah, 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 wah. How's that, Jean-André?
Beautiful.
Thank you. Jean-André says, beautiful. Anyway, that's what we can hear from the top where we're sitting. And that's the zebra calling at each other. They might not necessarily be alarming at each other, what that's them calling. Let's just have one last look at the lioness. See what she's doing there. All in infrared light. We are, just to keep you posted, every time I say, ooh, genre, go left or right, it's not because I can see in the dark with infrared. It's because we've just, because everything's settled down now, we're casting a very dim sort of white torchlight around the place just to see if there isn't any kind of action going on. That is, yes, that's slightly disconcerting. Look at the size of the lioness's paws compared with the head of that zebra. So everybody, if you are feeling a bit sensitive, I'm sorry about that. That zebra, obviously, I know you can see its eyes, but clearly it's not feeling any kind of pain. And if this is a little bit disgusting for you, I'm sorry. But this is what happens. This is the raw savagery, awe-inspiring as it is, of the African wilderness. And that zebra, I promise you wouldn't have felt a thing. It just would have suddenly thought, ooh, there's something amiss here, and then ba-bum, and would have been smacked by all six of these lions. Just look at the size of her paw there, everybody. That's about the same size, well, a little bit smaller than my hand. And you can hear the crunching there. And you can also probably hear that the rain has stopped. And interestingly, not quite the same frog noises that you were getting there at Juma. Brilliant. Let's have one last look at the hyenas, off to the left and to the right. And then I think we'll probably call it quits for the evening. Okay, everybody, thank you very much for watching us. It's been an incredible evening. We're going to probably make our way home and see what happens. And we'll join you, of course, tomorrow. Big thanks to the final control, to Jandre for his manful work on the camera today. Big thanks to Jamie and Taylor and the team at Juma. And we'll see you tomorrow at 4 o'clock East African time, 3 o'clock Central African time. It's been a wonderful evening with us, and thank you for joining us. We'll see you later. Bye-bye.